Welcome to Church History, welcome to 401CH, welcome to episode 15, how boring can we make religion? Ha ha! What a challenge. Okay, we're going to see the outworkings of those dissatisfied with Elizabeth's Via Media, the swing towards Puritanism, and towards Catholicism continue, the authority of who can remove a God-ordained king. And a little rewind, what are the European Catholics getting up to during this point? So here we go, I'm looking at page 18 of 39, the beginning of section 15 in the lecture notes. Puritans, a quote from H.L. Meekin, that haunting feeling that someone somewhere may be happy is the picture that we have of what Puritans are about. Not helped at all by horrible histories, really not helped in that way, nor for the matter by Blackadder and the cunningly shaped turnips and other such jokes that get thrown around. So not really helped by that. Art depicts them in austere clothes, but that's just because they're wearing their Sunday best. A little mercy, a little kindness, I think, towards the Puritans would be good. Elizabeth, in her settlement, she was going for the Via Media, so she was trying to keep that balance things so that the beliefs were quite Puritan in their language, but the outward trappings, you were allowed the cross at baptism, the surplice, kneeling at communion, bishops, things like that, you were allowed to keep them. But this sort of didn't make either side very happy, and so you have, to some extent, the rise of Congregationalist Baptists, that sort of thing, happening at this time. The Mayflower sets sail. Now, Elizabeth dies, and we have James VI of Scotland, the First of England. James I. And we're about to see James, Charles, well, and then James. But we're not going to do that, get that far in this moment. And James VI of Scotland, the First of England, he's not so keen on these Puritans. But to begin with, there's hope. James I, marvellous! How exciting, because James VI of Scotland has had a Presbyterian upbringing. So he's going to be a proper evangelical, proper low church, surely. But something happens as he travels and the southern soft English air, I don't know, and suddenly he seems to be keen on the sovereign right as derived directly from God. So, courtesy of King James, we have our King James Bible, the KJV, King James Version. So thank you to him for that. You probably already got one of those, but what you might not have is a Tyndale Bible from 1526. So I do recommend you read this. I found when I read it, I have to read it out loud. I can't read it in my head because this is written before the days of spelling. So get yourself one of these and see if you understand what I'm saying. And perhaps when we meet for a seminar, I'll show you what I mean by that. So that was James I. The king is dead, long live the king. Here comes Charles I. Now Charles had a strong sense of the divine right, and his marriage to a Roman Catholic caused a few hackles, a few problems to be concerned. He got a hold of the English prayer book, not the 1662 version, we're still predating that, that's still to come. He got a hold of the prayer book and he made an effort to impose it upon the Scottish church, and it provoked riots in Edinburgh. Well, why wouldn't it? What I need you to bear in mind somewhere along the line as we explore the divine right of kings is this complicated relationship between the crown and the church and parliament. And so the king has this sense of divine right, but where does that come from? Well, it sort of comes from the church. And so without the church, there is no divine right, because it's the church who say, yes, God, without their interpretation of the Bible saying this is where kings come from. You need the church on your side in order to bolster your sense of divine right. That's quite important. So you do need a strong faith and theology to go with that. And at the same time, you need your parliament, because it's out of parliament that comes money. And you need your parliament to give you your money. Now, it's Charles the First who leads us into the Civil War, and that leads on to his execution. And we shouldn't rush to just mock all this divine right of kings. Don't rush to mock it. It is the glue that holds society together. And the very definition of treason is surely killing your king. And so this is this understanding where we need to work out, is this for the good of the king or for the good of the country? And why are those two somehow become separated? Surely what is good for the king is good for the country. Isn't that what proper leadership would look like? But it sort of isn't what we have had in our kings of recent, in Charles the First. So we have our first, we have our English Republic, sorry, our Commonwealth and our Protectorate, and here comes Cromwell. And through the Rump Parliament, this reduced Parliament, we closed down theatres and we enforced a strict observance of Sunday. Saints' days no longer to be observed. Christmas, Easter, Whitsun are to be banned. They're just too raucous and too reminiscent of Romish ways. And there are stories of soldiers going about town smelling for cooked meat just in case you were celebrating Christmas. Why would you think that that was a good thing to do? So here you've got this boringness of church and religion and faith. Now, 1658, Cromwell dies. His son Richard assumes the protectorate, but it's really not his cup of tea. And so General Monk ensures the return of the king. And so we have Charles II. The English experiment with republicanism is over. Now, Charles II comes along. And he's keen to be lovely to everybody. Let's have an amnesty. Let's have religious toleration. I'm still going to dig up Cromwell's grave. Oh, yes. And I'm going to absolutely hunt down every last person who signed my dad's death warrant. It's a very good book, Killers of the King by Charles Spence, which goes through each of those people. And so through this, Puritanism loses its power. Theatres are reopened. Yay! And people start enjoying religion again. So we have at last, during Charles II's reign, the Book of Common Prayer, 1662 Book of Common Prayer, as we have it. Now, just for a moment, here we are in 1662, but we're going to pause and we're going to rewind to 1517. To the Reformation, and just we're going to say what's going on in the Catholic Church. We looked at Luther and Zwingli and Calvin and so on, but we didn't explore what are the Roman Catholics up to during this period. Now it starts off with the Pope not being so fussed, but even he began to recognise the danger of Luther's thesis, because if authority could be found outside of the church, without the church, in the Bible, if authority could be found there, then the church's power and the church's ability to raise money, this is all in danger. It's all going terrible. But there's plenty of Catholics who are very keen to see a little bit of Reformation happen. And so we see this in the form of the Council of Trent and in the Jesuits, and I'm afraid in the rejuvenation of the Inquisition. So, the Council of Trent happened in Trento, North Italy, not the Midlands. I know you're disappointed about that, but it turns out that's how it is. So there you are. 1545 to 1563, the Council of Trento. Here we have an affirmation of transubstantiation, of justification by faith and works, of the seven sacraments. Now there's two sacraments nonsense from the Protestants. Full proper seven. We have an affirmation of the celibacy of the clergy, which you're thinking, well, you know, clergy have been celibate for years. They haven't really, actually. Lateran I in 1123 had this line in it about how it was desirable for clergy to be single, but if you're married already, then it would be undesirable to break the marriage as you come to the priesthood. So this insistence on the celibacy of clergy has not always been there. It's just that it feels like it has. So you've got the Council of Trento. You've got Jesuits. Now here's you've got this chap, Ignatius of Loyola. He's a warrior who gets wounded, and in his hospital bed he fantasizes about going into war and killing people. And after a while he gets bored of that, and he wonders if there's a different sort of fantasy that he could practice fantasizing about. And he reads his Bible, and he wonders if he could fantasize about being in the scripture story. And so we have the beginning of the spiritual exercises of Ignatius of Loyola, where I am imagining Christ and me together. And he begins this training for himself that he starts. Now it's out of this that he gathers others to himself, and from this begins the Jesuits, and their keen bugbear is education. They are really good at education, and they pursue that, and that continues to be a key mission tool for them, schools and education, in terms of how they go about their mission. And here we see some of their missionaries: Francis Xavier, Matteo Ricci, the work that they do in Japan and in China, and you've got some of this detail here. What's interesting here is the degree to which you see, shall I say, a Justin Martyr approach to mission, working with the culture that we find. And so Xavier, for example, endeavoured to make Christianity more acceptable to local Japanese culture by keeping an aspect, by keeping any aspect of local culture that didn't directly clash with Christian teaching. And so he retained ancient worship ceremonies, which he deemed to be essentially social rather than religious. And so he grew the church. By 1587, we believe there were 300,000 Christians in Japanese churches. Astonishing. Alas, a Roman Catholic delegation come over to see what's going on. They don't like what's going on. And the Emperor of Japan goes, "All right, what are you doing here? Oh my gosh, what's going on here?" And so as a result, there's a bit of a crackdown, as there's this concern about who are these Christians and their foreign allegiance. Now, hopefully you've got in your version a sort of footnote to a BBC story of a year or so ago, 2019, where somebody found they dug up a plate, Christ, an icon, if you like, of Christ on a bronze plate, and Japanese Christians were forced to stamp their feet on, to trample upon Christ, known as the practice of fumi, to put your foot on a bronze Christ. So, says this article, 500,000 Christians in Nagasaki were reduced to 20,000 and went into hiding, because you needed to do that to demonstrate that you were no longer a Christian. Might take your mind back in its own way, back to the days of Pliny, 112 AD, that we looked at the very beginning of this course. So, what we've been discovering is that Roman Catholics are better at mission and evangelism than Protestants. They've been getting on with it in that way. We will come to Protestant mission, but not for a little while, because the Roman Catholics have been getting on with it. So, over the page to the wars of religion. And this is rather sorry and sad in a way. But on the plus side, the Protestant German princes, they form the Schmalkaldic League in order to defend, to come together as a unity to defend themselves against what's going on for others. And so they're able to defend themselves as a bloc. Nonetheless, war breaks out. And it results eventually in 1555 with the Peace of Augsburg. And at this point, each prince gets to say, "All right, well, I am Protestant." And some other prince gets to say, "Well, that's good for you. I am Roman Catholic. And because I'm a prince, that's what's going to happen in my territory. In my territory, it's going to be, this is going to be Roman Catholic because I'm prince of this. Well, this is going to be Protestant because I'm prince of this territory." Now, on the plus side, that brings a level of peace. There's an ability for you, if you're in the wrong territory, to move. Not a problem. You just move. Or you can stay, and we'll try not to make things too difficult for you, but there's an opportunity here for you to go. So on the plus side, you've got some level of peace, and on the downside, you have this simplistic understanding, well, everybody's a Christian, it doesn't really matter too much. And so you lose what the Moravians will see as saying, well, no, not everybody is a Christian. So we lose that moment. I'm going to skip straight past the Huguenots and the St. Bartholomew's Day massacre. I'm going to skip straight past that and come to the German religious war, the 30 Years' War, between 1618 and 1648. Here again, scholars love to take hold of a really great story and make a complicated word, the defenestration in Prague. And that's where a couple of representatives of the Catholic Frederick are defenestrated. They are literally thrown out of a window. I hope you've got enough French to be able to see where that that phrase was going. And so starts a war. The war results in devastation, nearly a third of Germany killed. And at the end of it all, the boundaries remain the same. It's all a little bit disappointing. Nothing really comes of it. And so at last we arrive at the Peace of Westphalia in 1648. And so there we come. I'll let you read the rest of that chapter, but shortly we will come to chapter 16 and we'll look at witches, fat slumbers, and dear God, please, some awakenings. See you shortly.